morning, everybody. We're about to start this panel. But before that, I just wanted to say a few words on behalf of the University of Buenos Aires and the organization of the AMUT. We are very happy to have you all here. I see the organizers sitting here at the front. Here's Chris Campbell. And we are very happy at the university to have this international event in our house. So it's really good to see you all here, some old friends and hopefully some new friends. It's gonna be an intense but very fun competition. So, and there will be a lot of silence before furthermore about the hearings, and there will be also a social agenda and everything, so you're gonna be posted about what's gonna happen every day. So now I'll introduce you to Francisco Amacho. He's presenting this ICDR panel. We are missing a speaker yet. He's on his way, so he's gonna be a bit late, but when that happens, then he will be added to the panel. So Fran, so yes.
Thank you, Pablo. Well, on behalf of ICDR and International, I would like to thank you for being here, and especially thank you for to the speakers for sharing their time and knowledge with us. For those who are not aware or familiar with our organization, ICDR, the International Center for Dispute Resolution, is the international division of the American Arbitration Association. It's the division that administers and handles the international arbitration cases. And this division has a subdivision, Young and International. It's a network for young practitioners. Membership is free of charge, so in case you are not already a member, we encourage you to become one just by going to our website and filling in a form. And that's it. From that, you will start to receive news about our events. We normally organize events around the world about international arbitration. And this is, all of our events are free of charge, and this is because of the speakers. And normally, the institutions that host our events, so I would like to thank you as well, Pablo, to the University of Buenos Aires. So now well, we have an event on transparency in international arbitration, and I will give the floor to Julian Cortazar. He is a former associate Baker and McKenzie. Now he's studying in Geneva and LLM in international dispute settlement, which in my personal view is the best LLM in international dispute settlement, but I should say I'm biased because I did that LLM. But he received, he was granted a scholarship due to his academic and professional efforts. So I leave the panel to you and he will introduce the speaker.
Well, first of all, thanks Francisco for being really kind of you. Thanks for inviting us and thanks for organizing this event. A few words of thank you should also be given to the UEA authorities and the people working really hard in organizing this event. Also to the FBI MUT organizers who we have here. It's for me a really a truly pleasure to be here back home, see a lot of new friends. I myself started as an FBI MUT student in 2011, so I wish you all the best luck and I hope we have a great event. We have a very interesting panel here today, people coming from all over the world, so let's enjoy. The first speaker we're gonna have today is Pedro Martini. Pedro Martini holds an LLM from the University of California, Berkeley, and is currently an associate at Clear Legal TS Team Hamilton in Sao Paulo. He's also a board member of the FBI MUT. We actually did the FBI MUT in the same year, back in 2011, that's when we met, and we have remained good friends. So I'll leave you with the floor.
Thank you,
William.
Thank you all, thank you, Francisco, the University of Buenos Aires, the FBI MUT. It's good to be among friends here. People that I've met in the past in MOOCs and elsewhere. So I was asked to talk today about corruption and the doctrine of unclean hands. I'm aware that this is one of the
main topics of this year's days. But I would like actually to try to get to a little bit out of what the case has been discussing and try to give a broader view of the issues that may be involved when corruption is raised and unclean hands doctrine is argued by a respondent state in an investment arbitration. Well, I'll start saying that the issue of corruption is very complicated because it's not as black and white as it can seem from the beginning. And don't get me wrong, corruption is wrong. That part is as black and white as it can be. But when we talk about the consequences, the legal consequences of corruption, then we have a very wide range of different shades of gray. No pun intended there. So my objective here is that by the end of this, the 20 minutes that I have, I can raise to you different issues that tribunals may need to consider in the future when addressing issues of corruption, in particular when considering the doctrine of unclean hands. Well, first of all, I'd like to talk a little bit about the idea of corruption. When we talk about corruption, the first thing that comes into mind is the traditional, I'm paying you to do a favor for me. But things are not always as clear as that. The FCPA, the Foreign Corrupt Practices Act from the US, has a little bit of a broader definition of corruption. If we look at it, it says that corruption exists when anything of value is given with the intent or desire to wrongfully induce the recipient to misuse his position. That's not exactly the wording of any provision, but that's the idea that we get, especially from the DOJ's guide on the FCPA. If you see here, we're talking about anything of value. And anything of value is not necessarily a certain amount of money. We're talking about exchange of favors. We're talking about gifts. We're talking about any benefit granted to one body, from one body to the other. And the intent here is to wrongfully induce the recipient to misuse his position. In the case of the FCPA in particular, intent is all that one needs, even if the benefit is not actually granted to the other party. Now, okay, so now we have a broad definition of what corruption is, but corruption can take many forms. Doug Bishop wrote an article in which he refers to a book from Michael Reisman. He lists three main types of corruption. One would be the transaction bribe, which would be corruption where one party grants a benefit in exchange for a more expeditious performance of a certain activity. The second would be the variance bribe, and that's for a benefit in exchange for the non-enforcement of a certain law in that country. And the third would be what he calls the outright purchase of an official to work secretly for the interests of the person granting the benefit. Then Doug Bishop adds a fourth possible type of corruption. And he says that sometimes this is not considered corruption, but sometimes it is. It's the influence peddling. I'd like to talk a little bit more about this one, because later it can be important for when I raise the questions necessary for the unclean hands. Influence peddling is usually taken as simply as someone exercising influence over another, not necessarily receiving bribes from them. However, I believe that it's very hard to find someone exercising influence without a quid pro quo. It's hard to understand why an official or someone with a relationship with an official would exercise influence without benefiting from it. We can use a very simple example. A company makes a donation, like a campaign election donation, to a politician. The politician has influence over the appointment of state officials, and then later the politician exercises his or her influence over the official appointed, the appointee, so he can direct a contract for that company in the first place. So here we do not have a clear bribe being paid, but we do have a benefit being granted from one party to another in the chain until finally the undue influence to misuse a position in a government is used. So this is, I think, a classic case where influence peddling also can should be classified as corruption. Well, okay, and then now we get to where we have a concern about corruption in investment arbitration. First of all, we have a general context where recently we have been having more and more awareness about the necessity of anti-corruption measures and the enforcement of those measures. Definitely, we have more, we have older, older efforts being implemented in that sense. For example, the FCPA came after the Watergate scandal in the US. But it's more recently that we see, for example, a UN convention on anti-corruption measures, that we see the market implementing market regulation or guidelines to avoid corruption and to promote compliance. For example, 2 weeks ago, the ICC adopted guidelines for investment, international investments. And in those guidelines, there was a specific chapter on anti-corruption matters. So we see that there is a growing concern about how to handle corruption. Well, in the field of investment arbitration, the concern is more about what we see is a gradual shift looking for a greater balance in international investment relations. That means that more and more tribunals, countries, and the society as a whole is concerned about how investors observe certain matters of great importance for the public interest. And therefore, investors, arbitrators, society, arbitrators, and states look for investors to be complying with local regulations, and that includes local regulations on anti-corruption. Well, so now we get to the helm of arbitration. It's not my intent here to talk about the commercial arbitration and how the issues arise within that. Within commercial arbitration, we have concerns of public policy, if arbitrators should report, have a duty to report or not, and that's something that my friend Rebecca will be talking about right after. Our concern here is more about the recent notion that an investor should not benefit from a treaty if the investor has made its investment through corruption. That's precisely what the unclean hands doctrine is all about. It's based on a note or a traditional principle of law where one should not benefit or take advantage from its own willfully wrongful act, willful wrongdoing. So the investment was made through an illegal conduct, and therefore, if the investment was made through an illegal conduct, the investment should not be granted the same protection as legal investments made under that treaty. But where do the tribunals draw the legal basis for applying the unclean hands doctrine? In many, many cases, what we see is the tribunal looking at the treaty's language that states that investment should be made according to national law. That's, for example, the case in Mattel Tech. The tribunal saw the language saying the investment should be made pursuant to local laws, and then understood that an investment that is not made cannot be considered as within the scope of the PIT. Other tribunals, however, and here I can mention Phoenix versus Czech Republic, found that the ICSID Convention, or in other cases, we have general principles of international law or transnational public policy, would not require specific language in the treaty, but rather we have all these broad range of principles that require compliance with local laws for the benefit of the treaty. This is an amazing discussion. We could take 1 hour or even more on that. So I think this should be kept for a second or another opportunity. I would like to discuss a different matter. What I would like to focus on is on which factors the tribunal should take into account when considering the unclean hands. So the unclean hands was raised by one party, and we have allegations of corruption. What should the tribunal look for? The tribunals have mostly addressed issues of standard of proof. That's, I believe, one of the main points in the case here. Tribunals have been considering which kind of standard of proof they should apply, and they have been drawing notions from domestic legislation. So we see tribunals applying the balance of probabilities test, the preponderance of the evidence test, and even beyond a reasonable doubt test, as in the criminal common law standard. Well, I think that the debate between these standards lies in the very complex nature of how corruption is raised in investment arbitration. So first we have that the consequence of the applicability of the unclean hands is a jurisdictional consequence or admissibility consequence where the claims would be entirely dismissed. It's a very heavy consequence for the conduct that we're considering here. So tribunals may consider that there is a higher standard necessary for the application of the unclean hands doctrine. Second, we're dealing with conducts that naturally are very hard to be proved by hard evidence. So usually we're going to have circumstantial evidence. Let's consider the example that I mentioned before, where we have a donation. It may be considered legal under the law. Then we have a certain kind of influence happening under the curtains that nobody can see, and a contract directed at one body that maybe looks a little bit suspicious, but we cannot be sure. Like usually people try to hide their conduct through apparently reasonable reasons. So it's very hard to prove that, and requiring a higher standard may lead someone to dismiss an allegation where indeed it's going to be impossible to prove exactly with all the necessary proof. And finally, we're talking about conducts that are regulated under national law, usually as a crime. But when we're talking about investment arbitration, we're talking about the compensation request by an investor, and we're talking about pecuniary consequences of that alleged crime. So we not always are going to have an easy way of determining whether we need a higher standard of proof or a lower one. Well, again, I think this is a very hard issue to deal with, and I think that tribunals should try to stick less to an exact definition of a standard of proof and rather on the wave of the evidence that is presented to them. And looking at the wave of the evidence not only requires looking at whether a payment was made or whether you have a meeting, for example, a hearing, and someone just alleging that you know influence was made, but we have a wide range of other issues that tribunals should be addressing that I believe may arise in the future. So I'm going to focus on five main issues very quickly before I wrap up. So the first one is, did a corrupt act, and this, I'm sorry, this is one that some tribunals have already addressed, is did a corrupt act happen at the time the investment was made, or did it happen after the investment was made during its operation? So the question here would the investment have occurred but for the corrupt act? And if corruption occurs after the establishment of the investment during its operation, are we really talking about admissibility, or are we talking about quantification of damages or other matters that do not go to jurisdictional or admissibility issues? So that's the first point that I believe also maybe touches a little bit on the case here. The second point would be, did a corruption claim first appear during the arbitration or after the commencement of the dispute? Meaning, are we talking about a state and an investor already in dispute? So let's suppose, for example, the investor alleges the state has been violating the fair and equitable treatment. And then after that allegation, the police suddenly finds some evidence or suddenly starts an investigation into the investor. Could this be interpreted as a possible retaliation against the investor? And therefore, the tribunal should try to look deeper and have a higher standard, require a higher standard for the proof. Or are we talking about widespread action by the state previous to the dispute looking for corruption in the entire country, a very big operation, everybody already knows about it, many evidence is found. So are we talking about that, or are we talking about the first case where it happens after? The third point that I would like to raise is, when did the investor become aware of the corrupt conduct, and how did the investor react upon knowledge of that conduct? And here I get back, for example, to the FCPA. We have nowadays many investors that are under the obligation to keep strong internal controls and to try to self-report any issues that arise during the course of the business. So it's not uncommon nowadays for, let's say, a company is conducting an internal audit as usual and then finds a very suspicious payment. And then they hire, for example, an external auditor, a law firm, a local counsel, and a U.S. counsel to try to conduct an internal investigation so they can start to talk to the DOJ, to the SEC. When the investor finds that and self-reports, when the company self-reports that conduct, do we really need to impose such a heavy sanction on the investor for doing its duty and finding out that someone inside the organization did not follow the internal procedures? And again, here the question may be, does the investor adopt effective internal controls and policies to avoid corruption? So here we have to look at a little bit more, what is the investor doing in terms of taking measures against corruption? Maybe what happened here is that the agent went havoc and tried to get benefits for himself instead of trying to look for the interests of the company. And this brings me to the fourth point, which is who benefited from the corrupt act? I can give you a very simple example. The company executive who acts on his own behalf without benefiting the company. So for example, a company executive agrees with an official of the government that, you know, let's do this. I'm going to raise my internal proposal for this contract in the bid proceedings. You, in the government, grant the contract to my company. And when my company is hired, I'm going to make sure that we hire a subcontractor that is actually an offshore company that does nothing, does not provide any service. With that money, I'm going to pay you your bribe, and I'm going to take a share of it. So the company, in fact, the company of the agent that was corrupt and paid for the official is actually paying more for the service that it would be providing. It's not getting the profits because the additional share went to an offshore company for the payment of bribes. The official is gaining money and the agent is gaining money. So should the company here, in this case, really be sanctioned for the conduct of its agent outside its mandate? And for its own benefit, not for the benefit of the company. And finally, so I see it, I may be running out of time now. The fifth point is,
3 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Arthur. And the fifth point is, what is the state's approach to bribes? Are we talking here about an official that solicited a bribe? So for example, we have a contract ongoing, the operation is there, the establishment of the investment was not made through bribes, but then, all of a sudden, the official comes to the company and say, listen, you may face some problems with the contract unless you give me this special bag of money and I will take care of that for you. The second point within this final issue, are we talking about a state benefiting from the investment itself? Again, what we have many times is the state looking for a contract that will assist in its own activities. Is there any possibility that the state is going to benefit from that investment? And that includes, for example, measures by the state that are not related to the corruption issue at all. So if the state did expropriate the entire investment of the investor, even if at some point there was corruption, if we simply dismiss the claim by the investor, wouldn't we be unjustly enriching the state through its act of expropriation? Finally, do the state adopt very strict enforcement and anti-corruption measures? Or are we talking about a country where corruption is widespread, everybody knows bribes are paid, everybody pays for bribes, and now the state is just simply using this excuse to avoid its responsibility. So I think that my point here is try to raise these five general categories of issues that tribunals should start to look at instead of simply saying, well, we have this letter of law or a letter of provision saying the investment must be made in accordance to national law, and then looking whether there is an allegation strong enough or not and simply dismissing the claims. What we need right now, maybe, is arbitrators and parties trying to develop more these issues and discuss these issues at a deeper level so we can actually develop and have a better application of the doctrine of investment law. Thank you.
All right, so thank you very much, Pedro, for your interesting presentation. As you have seen, besides his excellent oral skills, he has also learned to be on time. and this is due to his time as being an FDI. Lots of food for thought in his interesting remarks, especially since one of the issues of this year's case. So I'm sure this has raised a lot of questions for you today, but the way we're going to structure it is please save those questions to the end. So each of the panelists will give their own speech, and after they're all done, we'll have the floor is going to be given to you. So please save them for later. With this, we're going to move now to a second topic, a very interesting and controversial topic as well. So now I'm going to introduce Rebecca Mosquera. She's an associate at Hughes Harvard Litigation and Arbitration Group. She's a dual qualified attorney in the Republic of Panama and New York, and she's fluent in Spanish. She has a strong experience in the oil and gas industry, stemming from her work with Royal Dutch Shell Company. She has been also involved in a variety of disputes involving Latin American countries, including Honduras, Uruguay, Argentina, and Venezuela. And she's currently engaged in a litigation arbitration arising out of alleged violations to the United States Uruguay PMC. So without further ado, I give the floor to her.
Good morning, everyone. I actually was afraid that they
were
not going to let me into the country because, you know, the
Well, I tried, but I failed.
Okay.
Influence here is not.
Well, you know, I told them it wasn't the first time in Buenos Aires, so, you know, that's why I decided that we need. So, thank you everyone for being here. Good morning. I would like to thank Francisco Maya personally and the ICDR Young International for inviting me to this conference. It's an honor to be here with all in your friends. And, well, as you know, my topic is whether arbitrators have a duty to report crimes. So it's really not a very easy topic to, you know, be black and white as well. Before I go into any further detail, at first impression, it seems like they don't have a duty to report crimes, right? The way that the arbitrators come across any crime in arbitration can be, first, I'll give a list of three, doesn't mean it's an exhaustive list. But first, it's sham arbitration for money laundering. Here you have two parties, it's a dispute that is not real, and the arbitrator will render an award in which there will be an exchange of money or transfer of money, and this money is actually proceeds from a crime. There's also a second one, would be a sham arbitration to avoid taxes. In this case, you have the two parties, one of them wants to do a transfer property or have transfer a big gift to another party, and then there will be a dispute that is not real, and they will settle and have an arbitrator memorializing this in an award, and that's how they transfer this property or this gift without paying taxes. Then the last one will be basically fraud, an arbitration just to cover a fraud, in which generally what happens is you have a one party, which is in the fraudster, in cahoots with an agent of the respondent, in which this agent will do everything possible for the arbitration to be in favor of the claimant. So, and as I say, this is not a list that is exhaustive, but it's generally what you can see in arbitrations. So, also when parties go to arbitration, they are expecting the expectation is that their matters are dealt privately and confidential. So if we look at that principle, and that's why arbitration is so much, it's ideal over litigation, it's because of the privacy and confidentiality that the parties, they want things not to be dealt in the public, right? If you go to litigation, you will be part of the public record, and although that doesn't mean that one of the parties doing the arbitration cannot go to the press and commenting about the case. Well, in that case, you actually have certain mechanism. You know, the other party can talk to the tribunal and say, hey, you know, we need this person to stop saying things to the press and the like. Even the ICDR rules in Article 37, they state that confidential information disclosed during the arbitration by the parties or by witnesses shall not be divulged by an arbitrator or by the administrator, except as provided in Article 30, unless otherwise agreed by the parties or required by applicable law. The members of the arbitral tribunal and the administrator shall keep confidential all matters related to the arbitration or the award. Like I said, this doesn't mean that one of the parties can go to the press and just comment about the case. So at first sight, like I said, like first impression, it seems like confidentiality may trump any duty that the arbitrators may have in you know, reporting a crime they have come aware in the process of dealing with the arbitration. Also, we have the ultra petita principle, in which arbitrators can only deal with whatever the parties have pled. So going outside what the parties have pled might render an award unenforceable under the New York Convention Article 5. So what should they do? Is there a duty? Is there, should there be a duty? And commentators have a different point of view in all of these issues. So when Francisco called me and said, do you want to talk about this? I was like, oh wow. I didn't sleep for about, you know, 3 weeks just thinking about this. And I finally talked to a colleague of mine who actually sits as an arbitrator quite often these days. And I asked him the question, do you think the arbitrators should have, or do they have a duty? So an example was given, and he said probably, I mean, right now they don't have a duty, but they should probably, and probably not. And it's very difficult, because if you are, you know, if you come across a panel of arbitrators and your expectation is your, you know, confidentiality and that the dispute is resolved, but then at some point you get out of the hearing and you're, you know, accused of another crime. Is that part of the expectation of the parties? So, for example, let me give you an example in which you have two parties. One is a Latin American company, the other one is a US company. And this is actually a true life example. At some point, if this was a contract to provide services of certain, of, I think it was goods, actually, it was a transfer of goods. And at some point, the Latin American party, the company, had a witness on the stand. The US attorney started cross-examining this person, saying, and the line of question was to discredit their testimony, right? And it says, so isn't it true that you have been living in the United States from, you lived in the United States from 2012 to 2014? Yes. Isn't it true that you were working during that time? Yes. Isn't it true that you don't have a permit to work in the United States? At that point, the arbitrator said, you need to stop that line of questioning. Because under US law, the arbitration was under New York law. It was, the seat of arbitration was the US. So, not working, I mean, working in the United States without a permit is a federal crime. So at that point, the arbitrator said, just stop that line of questions. I know what you're trying to do, but it has nothing to do with the arbitration. Should that arbitrator then go and report this person to the immigration authorities? It's completely unrelated. And I think arbitrators, to a certain extent, and they don't want to have that duty, because so they start reporting crimes, and who's going to appoint them as arbitrators? I mean, you know, it's a practical question. Another example is, you know, you have a panel of arbitrators. They are trying to assess the damages or how much a company, you know, what's the value of the company. And of course, I get all kinds of paperwork, bank statements, tax returns. and I come across the fact that one of the parties hasn't filed tax reports in about 20 years. What do I do as an arbitrator? Oh, this is only to ban damages, but I should go to the IRS and probably, you know, report this person. So it's a very tricky question, the fact that you can, you know, see if they have a duty. Some commentators say that since arbitrators render awards and they're actually, you know, they can be enforced or even set aside, they're at the same level as judges, and judges do have a duty to report crimes. Others say, well, not really, they don't have a duty because arbitration itself is private, it's confidential, it's outside the judiciary. So what tribunals have been doing is probably is assessing case by case on a case by case basis. I don't know if that's the best way to deal with the issue, or what would be the standard if we decide, okay, we're going to decide case by case basis, but you know, what's the standard? I think that that's a question for probably the legislators or the international institutions that might want to, you know, put this in black and white. So in that aspect, some tribunals have dealt with the issue as, okay, you know, this is, we have a contract here in which it was obtained by bribery, or, you know, there is a certain, it's not arbitrable. I cannot decide over this case. So they deny jurisdiction. Some others have said, okay, we do have jurisdiction, but we are going to, and then we're going to deal with the illegalities in the award. Because one of the other duties of arbitrators is actually to render an award that is enforceable. So they need to, you know, be probably very careful what matters they actually adjudicate and which ones they don't. So I think it's a very difficult question as to say they do have a duty. Should they? Probably. So, you know, so people that are, or commentators that are against arbitration don't say that this is like a no man's land, because, you know, if you get out of the arbitration, you gather all this kind of information, and crimes are not reported, or if you deny jurisdiction as a panel of arbitrators, what doesn't say that they can then go to another arbitration and then get the award? I think at that point, the award will tell when it's time for the award to get enforced. Then at that point, I think the judiciary can say, well, this is against our public policy, it cannot be enforced. So at this point, it's very difficult to say what arbitrators should do. So they have been dealing with it case-by-case basis. But as you can see, it has to do with the enforceability of the award. It doesn't have to do with their duty to report. So for me, I think that they, at the point that we are right now, yes, it should be dealt case by case basis. Not every case, you know, in my opinion, renders them to go and report the crime. In another case, for example, I mean, it is an extreme case. If I know right at the outset that there is a corruption involved, or in how the contract was procured, and how the arbitration is going to, you know, going to develop, then yeah, probably, arguably, they might have a duty to report that to the authorities. But again, you know, do arbitrators really want to, I'm sure they think, well, do I really want to get myself into this? Am I going to be, you know, appointed again as an arbitrator? And what is the role of the arbitrator? Is to adjudicate and to resolve a dispute, not to be a police. That's what some of them say. Well, then we have an extreme case. I'm in the middle of a hearing, and somebody, one of the witnesses, comes with a gun and shoots somebody. I mean, at that point, I think you should you know, probably report that to the authorities, not only the arbitrators, but whomever is in the room. So it's not a black and white answer. I think it should be dealt case by case basis at the point that we stand right now. And if there is any, you know, if we want more predictability in this aspect, I think it's up to the legislator to, or you know, to the to international institutions to create soft law where we can probably have some, you know, some expectation of what the outcome will be. But again, I think that will set us a little back into where arbitration is right now, and then arbitration is, it's always preferably over mediation for the whole principle of confidentiality. So I think at this point I'll have to say that case by case basis it should be dealt that way, unless, you know, I'm not sure that you have some things.
Well, yeah, I mean, I hope you do get some sleep now that the
situation is,
as you said, 3 weeks you had sleep because of
yes.
the controversy.
I know, I haven't. It's all his fault. So, thank you very much.
Thanks very much. Okay, thanks for this excellent presentation. Now we're going to move to the transparency issues. We have here Bernardo Guaya, also a good friend of mine. We're going to introduce him. Bernardo is a graduate attorney in summa cum laude, as mentioned, in corporate law from technical issues. Okay, Bernardo has graduated with mention in corporate law from the Universidad Bolivariana. He holds an LLM in international dispute settlement from the University of Geneva and the Graduate Institute of International and Development Studies, the MIS. Bernardo is currently a partner at Guayar and Bomboris Abogados, and he has worked at the firm since 2006. His practice focuses mainly on national and international commercial arbitration, investment arbitration, international litigation, and cross-border transactions. And prior to becoming a partner, Bernardo worked as an associate at the Washington DC office of Quinn Emanuel from 2014 to 2016. So now Bernardo, the floor is yours.
Well, thank you very much, Julian. First of all, I would like to thank Francisco for the great invitation. I'm really happy to be here with you all, and well, to share the panel with such exceptional lawyers. It's really a great honor to be back in Buenos Aires. Well, I was invited by Francisco to talk to you about two antagonistic concepts, or at least seem to be antagonistic, which are transparency and confidentiality. Can transparency and confidentiality as principles of arbitration live together? Why? Which one should prevail? And these sort of questions have been raising these kind of questions lately, we as the arbitration community, for different reasons. If we open most of the arbitration texts or remember the first lessons or lectures on arbitration, we would certainly identify confidentiality as one of the main inherent characteristics of international arbitration, right? Besides that, it has been sold to us as one of the key advantages of international arbitration. As a matter of fact, some years ago, in a recent survey conducted by the Queen Mary International Arbitration School of the Queen Mary University in London, 84% of the Inside Counsel's survey would admit that they chose, but one of the main reasons they chose arbitration over other dispute resolution mechanisms is confidentiality. However, this quality of or characteristic of confidentiality has been questioned lately. And is confidentiality really needed? What's the real scope of it? Do we really, can we really believe that arbitration is confidential? To determine this utility, we need to identify the meaning and the scope of confidentiality, right? According to Gary Bourne, confidentiality is perceived as an encouraging, efficient, and dispassionate dispute resolution, rather than trial by press release. He believes that confidentiality is a very good, a very important advantage of international arbitration because it reduces the risk in arbitration of damaging disclosure of commercial sensitive information to competitors or to customers and other, right? And it facilitates the settlement of the dispute by minimizing the role of public posturing or the pressure that the press could apply. While we all might think that it's obvious what confidentiality means and what the scope of confidentiality in arbitration could be, not all regulations or national laws would define clearly what is the scope of confidentiality, and they usually let it allow the parties to agree on the scope of confidentiality. Well, there are some exceptions. For example, the Norway Arbitration Act would state that nor the arbitration proceeding nor the award can be confidential unless the parties agree to it. However, as a general idea, confidentiality will cover the submissions presented by the parties, the existence of the very arbitration, the deliberation of the tribunal, the evidence presented by the parties, or any documentation presented by other parties that wouldn't be public, right? As an example of a provision, we have the Article 30 of the London Court of International Arbitration Rules that says that unless the parties expressly agree in writing to the contrary, that parties undertake as a general principle to keep confidential all awards in their arbitration, together with all materials in the proceeding created for the purpose of the arbitration and all other documents produced by another party in the proceeding, not otherwise in public domain. However, while confidentiality could be important for the parties to choose arbitration, right, we have to keep in mind that as most things in life, confidentiality is not absolute, and it's relative. We as users of arbitration or actors of the arbitration or part of the arbitration community cannot rely on confidentiality, for example, to choose one mechanism to settle a dispute, because the arbitration would keep confidential until the moment one of the parties decides to challenge the award. The moment the party decides to challenge the award and presents the request to vacate this award, the case file will become public. There are some exceptions. Or if, for example, one of the parties refuses to comply with the award, we need to seek for the enforcement of the award. And once we present the request for enforcement of the award, the case file would be also public, right? So that's something that we need to keep in mind. But besides these force limitations to these mandatory limitations to the confidentiality of arbitration, there has been many discussions and requests from the civil society or arbitration practitioners or and the arbitration community.
Well, let me begin by echoing the thanks that my fellow panelists have given to everybody, obviously to Francisco and his colleagues at the ICDR to have this opportunity to come and speak to you. It's always wonderful returning to beautiful Buenos Aires. Frankly, anything that allows me to escape the English autumn is always a very welcome indeed. Obviously, it goes without saying, I think Bernardo will all pass on our sincere condolences on your sad loss. I do congratulate the ICDR because I think we have an obsession in the international arbitration community on all things to do with heat. And in particular, the hotter they are, the more we like them. So we're always looking for the next hot topic. And I think this session combines the two hottest topics that actually are around. The corruption issue has been bubbling around for quite some time now and it is increasing in its importance and I think awareness. And so it's a fundamentally important issue that is only going to become even more important as time goes on and raises all kinds of issues that, frankly, it is difficult to give a definitive answer. Nobody really knows. A lot of this is still very much up in the air. But the other thing that kind of goes hand in hand with that is transparency. And frankly, this has got to be my personal view. Excuse me, my thing just went offline. This has got to be the hottest of all of them. I mean, frankly, who would have thought that you would be seeing in the streets of Germany and other places in Europe and in North America hundreds, not tens, hundreds of thousands of people demonstrating against this Canadian Free Trade Agreement with Europe or the one that still has finally been agreed but not yet to be ratified, or indeed the ongoing and contentious and quietly forgotten for the time being TTIP negotiations. Yes, of course, a lot of that is concerned about employee rights, welfare, environment, but a large focus of protest against that that's been led by the anti-globalization movement is the dispute resolution mechanism that are contained within these agreements. I think they've been shrouded in mystery for so long, people are inherently distrustful about them. They've seen a phenomena right around the world at all different levels. I think people not trusting the elites, not trusting those that govern, and this is being reflected. And so it is right up there, I think, is one of the issues of our time. I've prepared a very short presentation, and as always, I always have to begin with an apology as well, because inevitably, given the limitations of time, I'm going to have to run through this a little bit quicker than I would like to. The one good thing, I hope, about having the presentation, everything I'm going to say is on the slide, so feel free, please, to either ask me for them, or I'm sure Francisco will circulate them to you. But it basically falls into three parts. There's an introductory section where I hope you can hear me over the noise that's been whirring in the background since we started. But an introductory section that really sets the scene, and I'm probably going to devote most of my time to that part, because the rest of it, I think, is more box ticking that you can read for yourselves and no doubt already know for yourselves. I'll be looking specifically at the UN transparency rules and the UN Convention on Transparency. And then if time allows me, just a couple of thoughts in terms of conclusions to wrap it up. And hopefully there's more than enough material already, I think, to provoke debate and views. So without further ado, I'll just fire on ahead. And as with all great entertainers, you need a beautiful assistant. So in this case, I think Pedro, if you wouldn't mind taking that role, I'd be very grateful. Sure. So we'll start.
Sorry, you said beautiful?
Yeah. Well, I've got to make do with what I've got.
Can you just give me the sign?
Yeah, I think if you can say that basically takes us to slide 4. So just get straight into that. So in terms of, as I said, putting things in context, I think it is worth just pausing
for a minute, just thinking about the numbers. I mean, this is a phenomenon. Sorry, I should have also said this is really focused at investor-state arbitration. And as I read, I think in some of the literature regarding the competition, people refer to Buenos Aires as being the Jerusalem of the investor-state world. And in many ways, it'd be a more better place to talk about investor-state. Issues. I mean, the transparency issues, everything we've been talking about, hearing about today, clearly overlap both commercial international arbitration, which we should never forget is by far the bulk of the international arbitration that exists, but clearly that that gets far greater prominence is much more publicly available, and hopefully will be more so as a result of the move towards transparency in investor state. But certainly, this is a phenomenon that's grown in the last 20 years. And I think if you pause to think that in 1998, not that long ago, I think most people were alive then, there was something like 15 known investor state cases. By the end of 2014, which is still just 2 years out of date, that number had jumped to 608, representing, for those of my numbers and statistics, an over 4,000% increase in the number of cases. So I think without any doubt, investor-state arbitration has become an alternative, an important alternative for international dispute settlement. So treaty-based investor-state arbitration claims arise under treaties providing for investment disciplines in investor-state dispute settlement. And these are by far the biggest instruments that one sees are the bilateral investment treaties, or BITs. These claims relate to challenges to the state's exercise of its sovereign power. In the past, investor-state arbitration developed mainly within the terms of confidentiality that we've just been hearing about and privacy that characterized commercial arbitration. Hence, access to investor-state arbitral awards would be denied, as well as the right to know that a particular dispute even existed, believe it or not, and there would be a little or no opportunity for non-disputing party participation in investor-state participation. Federal, next slide, please. In fact, transparency is still an undefined term in investor-state arbitration. Depending on the context, transparency may refer either to, one, to increase public information, or two, increase public participation in the proceedings themselves. Thus, transparency may refer to public access as regards either or all of the following issues: the existence of an investor-state dispute, with or without publication of the notice of arbitration and subsequent pleadings; the resolution of investor-state dispute, with or without publication of the award itself; the hearings; the dispute settlement process through amicus curiae or non-disputing party mechanism. Slide 5, please, Pedro. So the arguments in favour, well, why, you know, it might seem self-evident, but obviously this has been the situation for a long time. Why have increased transparency at all? Well, there are many different factors, but so these are, I think, the consensus tends to cover these. One is to have good governance, and transparent investment agreements make arbitrary actions by host states less probable. That's the theory, at least. They're doing this, their work in under the gaze of public attention. So both enabling good governance and increasing the cost of the breach. Speaking in connection with UNCTRAL's new rules on transparency that I'll touch on, Michael, the chairman of UNCTRAL, noted in support of the General Assembly's endorsements of the rules that, and I quote, transparency lies at the very foundation of good governance. So accountable government requires that the governed, that's you and me, have information about how they've been governed in order that they might hold those in power to account. As I was saying, this is, I think, is a global phenomenon. Beyond the question of whether the state has discharged its substantive international obligations under an investment treaty, an investor-state claim will raise questions about the state's prospective exposure to liability. This is a very important part, I think, and easy to forget. Just one anecdotal story, just to bring these things to life. I was involved a few years ago, completely by surprise. It wasn't planned in the Icelandic climate, or the aftermath. It wasn't my fault that they had a financial crisis in Iceland. But I was involved quite extensively in the aftermath of the financial crisis there. It was interesting
But for the first year, I mean, the legal basis was fascinating, and nobody ever really got to the bottom of how it all worked. It was being candidly made up as it went along. But after the first year, the government, notwithstanding being in a situation where the country was at least bankrupt eight times over, still managed to get the sympathy of their own public, because of the public relations, and there were attempts to change and just provide more information in the interest of transparency, because they had always been assured that actually it wasn't that big a problem, and all things under control. And then when the country realized quite what extent of the liability, and this would take at least a generation to fix, it suddenly focused the mind of those in power in Iceland to perhaps negotiate on a different basis. So I just share that with you, because it was as obvious as it might seem, and those involved in the front line, so to speak, knew that. The general public certainly had no idea. And so I think accountability in that regard is very important. Protection of human rights. It's not just states, but investors have obligations regarding their impact of their activities in a host state. And indeed, the United Nations has, in 2011, prepared some guiding principles on business and human rights. And again, that great transparency, it enables those with an interest to monitor what is going on and to hold those to account. The legitimacy of investor-state arbitration, if anything, I think we are candidly all guilty in the international arbitration community of dropping the ball on this or never even picking it up, because the anti-globalization movement that used to go around smashing up McDonald's on an annual basis in some parts of the world have become far more sophisticated and concentrated on the aspect and on the more less transparent parts of these international free trade agreements that I've mentioned before. But I think one way to counter that is to shed more light on the whole process, and so people can see for themselves and judge for themselves whether or not the claims and counterclaims that are being made are justified. We heard as well about publications of awards. While there is no public body of jurisprudence precedent of previous awards, I think it clearly makes helpful for everybody involved in these rather complicated agreements to have equal knowledge, both sides, so equality of arms in terms of the knowledge available, to know how awards have been interpreted and going forward. So I think that's important to have transparency in that regard. And it goes to the equality of arms for both sides. One thing that's not on the slide is state treaty development. It may again go without saying that I think it will help. There's a whole wave of bilateral investment treaties either being revised or new ones coming into place. And clearly, I think having information and being able to analyse cases that have come before tribunals and be decided to help them, those that are drafting these treaties, model them in a way that makes sense for them and that they know what they're going into and dealing with, not falling into the traps that many have fallen into. I noticed, I think we have some colleagues from India. India had a place close to my heart where I've done a lot of work over the years, but India got burnt and badly in the case of White Industries, where that started off as commercial arbitration. But it became subject to investor state arbitration, bilateral investment treaty claim, for failure to enforce the award within an expeditious time. And in that case, it was something like 7 or 8 years, I think, which anybody dealing with India will know that's actually pretty quick. But they were held to be to have fallen foul of the Rome bilateral investment treaty. But it was upwards in India, because people had no idea that their bilateral investment treaty could be used in that way. And you had the extreme view was to say, we're never going to rip up every agreement we have, we're never going to do these again. That died down a bit, they're coming up with a bit of help model their new in bilateral investment treaty. So that's an important aspect. So next slide, please, Pedro.
Okay, so despite the benefits which flow from enhancing transparency in investor-state arbitration that I just mentioned, most international investment treaties currently in force do not contain express provisions to this effect. Well, I mean, that's partly, I think, a timing issue, obviously. While the most treaties are silent with respect to transparency and other procedural matters pertaining to the investor-state arbitration, the vast majority of treaties simply references the various types of arbitration available under the dispute resolution provisions and thereby incorporates the relevant arbitral rules. That said, you know, I'll just pause one second, just picking up, because Bernardo mentioned the LCIA express clause on confidentiality, an interesting one that often catches people out. The ICC, the biggest of the lot, they don't have one. And I only mention it is that, I mean, you get round up by expressly putting in a confidentiality clause, but don't assume you get automatic confidentiality. If you really want it, the safest way is to expressly put in there. So, you know, and these are major institutions, but there are very subtle and important differences between them. But I think, notwithstanding that, I think you can, it's probably fair to say, detect a trend that is steadily developing in favour of including within the treaties themselves provisions which require transparency in investor-state arbitration, regardless of whichever system of arbitration is chosen. It tends to be led by our North American colleagues, or indeed in North America, I'm including Mexico, so it's the NAFTA guys, really, so Canada, Mexico, the US, through their BITs and their free trade agreement, have developed what has been termed the North American approach, which really is very much pushing for transparency. The Europeans, notwithstanding the fact that, get this, they have over 1,200 BITs, almost all of them contain no provisions regarding transparency in investor-state arbitration. Having said that, the European Commission was a strong and public supporter of the new UN transparency rules throughout its drafting process, and has indeed now become very much the core of the EU's emerging international investment treaty policy, with the Commission advocating for the adoption of the rules not only in the EU's new investment treaty, but also in existing investment treaties of the member states. Indeed, I've already mentioned the negotiations with Canada, but with Singapore, the European Commission has made the antitrust rules its basic a page incorporating that baseline in its negotiating position. Moreover, in its negotiations with the United States, this is regarding the TTIP, the Transatlantic Trade and Investment Partnership, they've gone even further than the existing transparency rules and the US treaty practice, the North American process of practice that I mentioned before. So certainly, I think from in recent times, it's been catching up fast, and arguably that's where the most activity is and focus is in the world at the moment regarding this whole question. Elsewhere, I'm afraid it's a far patchier story, and candidly here in Latin America, I think one can say there's not really been so much of a move towards transparency unless there is a kind of reciprocal dealing with either the North Americans, mainly Australia, New Zealand, and the Europeans. But I think as within states within the region, there doesn't seem to be so much this push towards transparency. We've seen additional transparency provisions come up in the arbitral rules. ICSID, in their 2006 arbitration rules, was amended in an effort to increase transparency, and one is seeing now the growth of amicus applications. You can now watch hearings online, so that was very innovative, still growing, and I think we'll see more of that. The PCA in The Hague has also developed and opened up a number of its hearings. But then I think following the completion of the UNSA trial rules, the momentum continued with the development of the UNSA trial rules in 2010, then we have the transparency rules in particular in 2013. What we then saw following on from that was the UNSA trial Convention on Transparency and Treaty-Based Investor-State Arbitration, shorthand known as the Mauritius Convention, that was opened for signature in 2015. So the new transparency rules contain the most wide-ranging set of transparency commitments seen this far in international practice, and as such, the Mauritius Convention is an ambitious attempt to provide a platform to reform the entire landscape as regard the transparency investment arbitration. Should we be okay for time for a minute?
Yeah.
Okay, next slide. We're going to look at the very briefly, as I say, I think in the interest of time, and I'm very keen to allow you to hear your views. Just want to touch some of the key points. So I'm not going to go through every one of these because it is there on the slide, but just saying what the transparency rules are all about. As I say, they're very recent. Key provisions, the scope is set out as you would expect, right at the beginning in Article 1. And establish that they apply to all arbitrations conducted under the Unster Trial rules pursuant to a treaty, unless the parties to a treaty have agreed otherwise. But so these rules came into force on the 1st of April 2014. But you may also use they can be used in other arbitrations, such as ICSID, the PCA I've mentioned, or Stockholm. If parties want to avail themselves of it. Essentially, what they're aimed at doing is giving public access to documents. See this in Article 2. And notion of what's going on. So this will involve knowing an arbitration has started, names of the disputing parties, the economic sector involved in the dispute, and the identity of the treaty in which the claim is made, basic ingredients. Next slide, please. Article 3 requires that other documents produced must be made public as soon as possible, subject to certain exceptions which are set out in Article 7 of the rules. The following documents require mandatory publication. So you've got the notice of arbitration, the response to the notice of arbitration, the statement of claim, the statement of defence, a table listing all exhibits of any written submission, as well as two expert reports and witness statements. Entire documents would be available upon request of any party, of any person. Any written submissions by the third party or non-disputing parties, transcripts of hearing, orders, decisions, and award of the arbitral award. I don't think it's an exaggeration to say this is revolutionary. I mean, it's hard to read this when you look at the situation before or look at what we have now. It moves it into a completely different space. I, for one, welcome it, and I think that is the way to go, and hopefully, as I say, will allay a lot of the fears and suspicions that surround, some valid, some not so valid, the whole issue of transparency. Article 6 deals with access to arbitral hearings, again, subject to the exceptions in Article 7. That takes us to the next slide. Article 7 sets out what the exceptions are. There are really three of them. Non-disclosure of, well, perhaps none of this again is rocket science, but non-disclosure of, quote, confidential or protected information, namely consisting of confidential business information, information protected from disclosure under the relevant investment treaty, information protected against being made available to the public by law, information which disclosure would impede law enforcement. Also, there's a national security interest there, which kind of can't be, may be subject to the catch-all public policy exception, which may be a recipe for abuse, but we'll have to see in practice how that is used. And also, anything to restrain or delay the publication to protect the integrity of the arbitral process. Participation of third parties and non-disputing parties. This is dealt with in Article 5. If you go to the next slide, please, Pedro. All I'm going to say is that is now case 4 under the rules. As I said, apologies, because I'm going to have to start skipping a little bit now. Article 4, also associated with third parties, what they can do in applications, what they must consider. Next slide, please. The convention, this was adopted on the 10th of December 2014, so this is, you know, bang up to the minute. Essentially, as I said, it was to promote the application of transparency rules and provide a mechanism to give rules application not only to unsubtrial investor state arbitration, but to all investor state arbitration under state parties' investment treaty. So it really is the big push. The downside is that this was, as you'll see from, I think you can see it, the next slide, Pedro. Yes, I think I'll skip that. Then one after that, it came into it was signed at the end of 2014. Came into force in 17 March. It was signed. To date, it has been signed by only 17 members. Sorry, can you just go back one slide? I think it may have list them there. It's quite an interesting grouping of countries. You've got Belgium, Canada, Congo, Finland, France, Gabon, Germany, Italy, Luxembourg, Madagascar, Mauritius, obviously is where it was hosting the event, Netherlands, Sweden, Switzerland, Syria, United Kingdom of Great Britain and Northern Ireland. I don't know how long I'm going to be able to say that for, depending on how things turn out with Brexit, but anyway, it's there for the minute, and the USA. Sadly, that represents, by my calculation, less than 9% signed up members to the UN, so there's quite a long way to go, and the next map, Pedro, that you threw up, should represent that in a map form with a little bit of colour, so this is always nice, but as you see, there's a long way to go on this. But it's early days, I think is all I would say on that. Having said that, of the 17, only one country has ratified it, and that is Mauritius itself. So, people need to put their words into action and put it in the eating and follow through. So there's still some work to go there. I think that takes me to the concluding slides. And I think I could just end really by saying, I know I've just gone, you've indulged me. thanks to the generosity of the other speakers, I think you can go a few extra minutes. I think it's just say, watch this space. The title was The Impact of the UN Convention. It's not had much of an impact yet. I think it depends on what level. I think in terms of big picture level, it's fantastic development. And I think it completely changes the rules of the game. In terms of actually seeing material change, the jury's still out. There's a reference to a case there that will show some evidence of how this is being dealt with by tribunals in all cases. I'll leave the references on the slide. And I think without further ado, I will sum up. Thank you for indulging me. Thank you for your attention and your patience. And I appreciate it. I hope that was helpful.